The story of Othello.
Brabantio, a rich senator of Venice, had a fair daughter, the gentle Desdemona, and she was sought by divers suitors, both on account of her many virtuous qualities and for her rich expectations. But she had chosen for herself a black man, Othello, who was a soldier and a brave one, and by his conduct in bloody wars against the Turks, had risen to the rank of general in the Venetian service, and although a foreigner and a Moor, was esteemed and trusted by the state. He had been a traveller, and Desdemona loved to hear him tell the story of his adventures, which he would recount to her from his earliest recollection, the battles, sieges, and encounters which he had passed through, the perils he had been exposed to by land and by water, and his hairbreadth escapes. These traveller's stories so enchanted Desdemona that she wished that heaven had made her such a man, and then she thanked him and told him if he had a friend who loved her, he had only to teach him how to tell his story, and that would woo her and win her heart. Othello took the hint, which was delivered with bewitching prettiness, and he spoke more openly of his love, and in this golden opportunity gained the consent of the generous Lady Desdemona privately to marry him.
Neither Othello's colour nor his fortune were such that it could be hoped Brabantio would accept him for a son-in-law. For although he had left his daughter free to choose a husband, he did expect that as a noble Venetian lady she would choose a fellow Venetian and a man of senatorial rank. Othello and Desdemona's marriage, which, though privately carried out, eventually came to the ears of Brabantio, who appeared in a solemn council of the Senate as an accuser of the Moor Othello, who he claimed by spells and witchcraft had seduced the affections of his daughter to marry him without the consent of her father.
At this juncture, it happened that the state of Venice had immediate need of the services of Othello, news having arrived that the Turks had fitted out a fleet which was bending its course to the island of Cyprus with intent to regain that strong post from the Venetians. In this emergency, the state turned its eyes upon Othello, who alone seemed adequate to conduct the defence of Cyprus against the Turks. But first they had to hear the charges brought by Brabantio against their general. The grave assembly gave the old man a patient hearing, but the incensed father conducted his accusation so wildly and with such intemperance that when Othello was called upon for his defence, he had only to relate the plain tale of the course of his love, which he did with artless elegance, recounting the whole story of his wooing, and delivering his speech with such noble simplicity, that the Duke, who sat as chief judge, could not help confessing that a tale so told would have won his daughter too, and that Othello, in his courtship, had used no more than the honest arts of men in love. This statement was confirmed by the testimony of the Lady Desdemona herself, and the old senator, unable to maintain his plea, as an act of necessity, reluctantly bestowed his daughter upon Othello.
This difficulty being overcome, Othello readily undertook the management of the wars in Cyprus, and he and his lady immediately set out for the island. No sooner had they arrived than news came that a desperate tempest had dispersed the Turkish fleet, and thus the island was secure from any immediate attack. But the war that Othello was to suffer at the hands of a personal enemy was far more dangerous and proved far more deadly than anything that could have been inflicted by strangers or infidels. And our story now takes a sad and desperate turn.
Among all the general's friends, no one possessed the confidence of Othello more entirely than Cassio, a young Florentine soldier, of pleasing address, handsome, eloquent, and a great favourite with the ladies. Exactly such a person as might alarm the jealousy of a man advanced in years, as Othello was, who had married a young and beautiful wife. But Othello was as free from jealousy as he was noble, and as incapable of suspecting anyone as of doing a base action. He had employed Cassio in his love affair with Desdemona as a sort of go-between in his suit, so that no wonder, if next to Othello himself, The gentle Desdemona loved and trusted Cassio. Nor had the marriage of this couple made any difference in their behaviour towards Cassio. He still frequented their house, and Desdemona and he would spend many hours together talking and laughing, as in the days when he went a-courting for his friend.
Othello had lately promoted this same Cassio to be the lieutenant, a place of trust and nearest to the general's person. This was to prove the most disastrous mistake of Othello's life, for it gave great offence to Iago, an older officer who thought he had a far better claim to the position than Cassio, whom he ridiculed as being a fellow fit only for the company of ladies, and who knew no more of the art of war than a girl. This Iago hated Cassio, and he also hated Othello, for apart from having promoted Cassio, he had an unjust suspicion that the Moor was too fond of his wife, Emilia. From these imaginary provocations, the plotting mind of Iago conceived an evil scheme that would involve both Cassio, the Moor, and Desdemona. Iago was artful and had studied human nature deeply, and he knew that of all the torments which afflict the mind of man, the pains of jealousy were the most intolerable and had the sorest sting. If he could succeed in making Othello jealous of Cassio, he thought it would be an exquisite revenge and might end in the death of Cassio or Othello or both. He cared not.
The arrival of the general and his lady in Cyprus, meeting with the news of the dispersion of the enemy's fleet, made a sort of holiday in the island. Everybody gave themselves up to feasting and making merry. Cassio had the direction of the guard that night, with a charge from Othello to keep the soldiers from excess in drinking, that no brawl might arise to fright the inhabitants or disgust them with the new landed forces. That night, Iago began his deep-laid plans of mischief. He enticed Cassio to make rather too free with the bottle, and for a time Cassio resisted, but Iago still plied him with drink and encouraging songs until he swallowed glass after glass. At last, the drink which he put into his mouth stole away his brains, and upon some provocation given him by a fellow whom Iago had set on, swords were drawn, and Montano, a worthy officer, who interfered to appease the dispute, was wounded in the scuffle. The riot now began to be general, and Iago, who had set on foot the mischief, was foremost in spreading the alarm, causing the castle bell to be rung.
The alarm bell awakened Othello, who, dressing in a hurry and coming to the scene of action, demanded to know the cause of the trouble. Iago, pretending a great reluctance to accuse Cassio, but, as it were, forced into it by Othello, who insisted to know the truth, gave an account of the whole matter in such a manner as, while he seemed to make Cassio's offence less, did indeed make it appear greater than it was. The result being that Othello, who was a strict observer of discipline, was compelled to take away Cassio's position of lieutenant from him. Cassio, whom this misfortune had entirely sobered, now lamented to his seeming friend Iago that he should have been such a fool as to transform himself into a drunken beast. Iago, affecting to make light of it, advised him to apply to the lady Desdemona to mediate for him with her lord, for she would readily undertake a good office of this sort and set Cassio right again in the general's favour. A good piece of advice from Iago, if it had not been given for wicked purposes, which it will after appear.
Cassio then did as Iago advised him, and made application to the lady Desdemona, and she promised Cassio that she should be his solicitor with her lord. She immediately set about this in so earnest and pretty a manner that Othello, who was mortally offended with Cassio, could not put her off. When he pleaded delay, she showed how penitent and humbled poor Cassio was, and when Othello still hung back, she rebuked him, saying, "What, my lord, that I should have so much to do to plead for Cassio, that same Cassio that came a-courting for you? I count this but a little thing to ask of you. When I mean to try your love, indeed, I shall ask a weighty matter."
Othello could deny nothing to such a pleader, and only requesting that Desdemona would leave the time to him, promised to receive Cassio again in favour. Now it so happened that Othello and Iago had entered the room just as Cassio, who had been imploring her intercession, was departing at the opposite door. And Iago, who was full of cunning, said in a low voice, as if to himself, "I like not that." Othello took no great notice of what he said at the time, but after Desdemona was gone, Iago, as if for mere satisfaction of his thought, questioned Othello whether Cassio, when Othello was courting his lady, knew of his love. To this the general answered in the affirmative, adding that Cassio had gone between them very often during their courtship. Iago knitted his brow, as if he had got fresh light on some terrible matter, and cried, "Indeed." This brought into Othello's mind the words which Iago had let fall upon entering the room on seeing Cassio with Desdemona, and he began to think that there was some meaning in all this, for he deemed Iago to be a just man, and full of love and honesty. He then prayed Iago to speak what he knew, and to give him his worst thoughts and words.
Iago, as if in earnest care for Othello's peace of mind, besought him to beware of jealousy. And with great art did this villain raise suspicions in the mind of the unguarded husband. He told the Moor that he was glad that Othello was slow to believe ill of his lady, and that he understood that he would need proof before believing her dishonest. But he begged him to observe her behaviour well when Cassio was by. And then he artfully insinuated that Desdemona had already deceived her father in marrying with Othello. Othello was much moved with this argument, for if she had deceived her father, why might she not also deceive her husband? And although he assumed indifference, he was really shaken with inward grief at Iago's words and begged him to go on. Iago did so with many apologies, but advised Othello to put off his reconcilement with Cassio a little longer, and in the meanwhile to note with what earnestness Desdemona should intercede on his behalf. So mischievously did this artful villain lay his plots to turn the gentle qualities of this innocent lady into her destruction, and make a net for her out of her own goodness to entrap her, first setting Cassio on to entreat her mediation, and then out of that very mediation contriving stratagems for her ruin.
From the moment his conference with Iago ended, the deceived Othello never again tasted contentment of mind. His occupation sickened him. He no longer took delight in arms. His heart, that used to be roused at the sight of troops and banners and battle array, now seemed to have lost all that pride and ambition which are a soldier's virtue. All his old joys forsook him. Sometimes he thought his wife honest, and at times he thought her not so. Sometimes he thought Iago just, and at times he thought him not so. Torn to pieces with these distracting thoughts, he once laid hold on Iago's throat, demanding proof of Desdemona's guilt. But the cunning Iago had thought of this as well. He asked Othello if he had not sometimes seen a handkerchief spotted with strawberries in his wife's hand. Othello answered that indeed it had been his first gift to her. "That same handkerchief," said Iago, "did I see Cassio wipe his face with." It was a masterstroke, the proof that Othello needed. "If it be so," now said Othello, "I will not rest till a wide revenge swallow them both. Cassio shall be put to death within 3 days, and for that fair devil, my wife, I will devise some swift means of death for her as well."
Of course, Desdemona had never given such a present to Cassio, nor would this constant lady ever do such a thing. But the wicked Iago had made his wife steal the handkerchief from Desdemona, under pretense of getting the work copied, but in reality to drop it in Cassio's way where he might find it, and give a handle to Iago's suggestion that it was Desdemona's present to him. Othello now pretended he had a headache, and desired Desdemona to lend him the handkerchief spotted with strawberries to hold to his temples. But Desdemona did not have it with her, because, of course, it was stolen. Othello rebuked her, saying,
"This is a fault indeed. That handkerchief was given to my mother by an Egyptian woman who was a witch. She told my mother that as long as she possessed it, she would be amiable and my father would always love her. But if she lost it or gave it away, my father's fancy would turn and he would loathe her as much as he had formerly loved her. She, dying, gave it to me and bade me, if I ever married, to give it to my wife. I did so. Take heed of it and make it your most precious possession.
On hearing this, Desdemona was ready to die with fear, for she plainly perceived she had lost the handkerchief, and with it, she feared, the affections of her husband. So she tried to divert Othello from too serious thoughts, and cheerfully told him she saw all his talk about the handkerchief was only to put her off from her suit about Cassio, whom she went on to praise, till Othello, in perfect distraction, burst out of the room. Then Desdemona, though unwillingly, began to suspect that her lord was smitten with a terrible jealousy. Later that day, Othello and Desdemona met, and he accused her more plainly of being unfaithful and of loving another man, but he did not name whom. And Othello wept, and Desdemona said, "Alas, the heavy day! Why do you weep?"
He replied that he could have borne all sorts of evils with fortitude, poverty, disease, and disgrace. But her infidelity had broken his heart, and he called her terrible names and wished she had never been born. And when he left her, this innocent lady was so stupefied with wonder at her lord's untrue suspicion of her that a weight-like sleep came over her, and she retired to bed and soon fell into a slumber. Othello entered the chamber, full of the black purpose of putting his lady to death. But when he saw her asleep, he thought he could not shed her blood, nor scar that white skin of hers, more white than alabaster. But then again he was resolved she should die, else she should betray more men as she had done him. Then he kissed her for the last time, and that kiss was so sweet that he must needs kiss her again.
Desdemona was awakened with his kisses, and she looked upon Othello, who bade her prepare for death and to say her prayers, for he would not kill her soul. And this innocent wife, as she lay at his mercy, begged for compassion and to know her fault. And then he named Cassio and the handkerchief which he said she had given him. And as the guiltless lady was proceeding to clear herself of this deed, he suddenly could bear no more, but covering her head with a pillow, he stifled the breath out of her until she died.
In this instant, Cassio was brought into the house, wounded and bleeding from an assassination attempt organized by Iago. But the killer, not succeeding in his attempt to murder Cassio, was himself put to death by Iago to prevent discovery. But in the assassin's pockets were found letters which made the guilt of Iago and the innocence of Cassio clear beyond all doubt. And Cassio now came to beg pardon of Othello, and to ask wherein he had offended him, that he had employed Iago to murder him. This discovery was as a thunderstroke to Othello, who now plainly saw that he was no better than a murderer himself, and that his poor innocent wife had ever been faithful to him. The extreme anguish of which discovery, making his life insupportable, he fell upon his sword, and throwing himself upon the body of his beloved Desdemona, he died.
These rash acts raised much passion of horror and amazement in all who witnessed them, for Othello had borne a fair reputation, and until he was destroyed by the arts of a villain, which his own noble nature never gave him leave to suspect, he was a loving and a doting husband. He had loved not wisely, but too well. And when he was dead, all his former merits and his valiant acts were remembered. Nothing now remained for his successor but to put the utmost censure of the law in force against Iago, who was executed with strict tortures, and to send word to the state of Venice of the lamentable death of their renowned general and his gentle wife.